They often say that the hills are alive with the sound of music. But if that's the case, Julie Andrews aside, then who's singing it? Our planet is a wondrous place, and our pale blue dot has been through so much turmoil and cataclysmic instances of geological phenomenon that it's hard not to appreciate the resilience of our third rock from the sun. But here's a question that perhaps is relatively easy to overlook, especially now in the 21st century where we happily go about our business, irreverent to the fact that we're hurtling through the cosmos at 67,000 miles per hour, safe in the comfort of our own home. But despite all of this, have we lost sight of what's actually beneath our own 2 feet? Hello internet, what's going on, and once again welcome back to the most inquisitive channel on YouTube, Life's Biggest Questions. As per usual, I'll be your disembodied flowing voice, Jack Finch, as today we curiously ask the question, what if the Earth was alive? Roll the clip. For the curious amongst you, that scene was from 2017's Life, starring Jake Gyllenhaal, which is fitting really, as after all this is a Life's Biggest Question about the only known astronomical entity that harbours sentient life, that we know of anyway, and if you've seen the ending to that film, you'll know that there's some kind of veiled warning hidden beneath that one. But we'll digress, because this question has many, many layers, most of which are seeded deep into the age-old interpretations of mythology, religion, culture and science, all of which approach this particular notion with equal parts intrigue and wonder. In many respects, the Earth is very much alive, but perhaps not in a way that meshes well with our modern civilization. The idea that our planet is alive may perhaps be as old as humankind itself. The ancient Greeks, in all their pantheonic wisdom, quickly came to that same notion. They gave her the all-powerful name Gaia, and they looked upon her as a goddess, the mother of all life. And this same idea emerges time and time again throughout ancient mythology as the embodiment of the bounty of Earth, a Mother Earth, so to speak, that gives life and harbours life all the same. There was Terra, Matsemnia, Pachamama, Prithi, the spider grandmother of Native American tradition, ancient Venus of Göbekli Tepe. In fact, across our planet's history, as life and civilization emerged, so did the seed of the idea that our Earth was a living and breathing entity. In a more contemporary setting, the renowned psychoanalyst Carl Jung suggested that this archetypal figure was the result of a formation of a collective unconsciousness of all human life, and that the universality of the Earth Mother harkened back to an innate knowledge that we all once shared. In fact, it was up until the early 20th century that science was on the exact same page too. In most respects, it has only been in the modern era that we've considered our planet to be some massive spinning rock with no feelings. In 1790, a man named James Hutton, who is otherwise considered to be the father of all geology, declared in a lecture at the Royal Society of Edinburgh that the Earth should be considered as a superorganism, a mass collective of living systems, biospheres and environments that were all delicately interwoven as one. And so the only logical approach to study our planet would be by means of physiology. James Hutton would later go on to make the analogy of the human body's circulation of blood to be exactly the same as our planet's circulation of the nutritional elements of the Earth. And that the process of sunlight distilling water from the oceans so that it may later fall back down as rain were one and the same. You can draw many, many parallels, but the most important instance is that James Hutton's seed of an idea later went on to be completely overshadowed by contemporary science in the next few centuries. Science boomed. It developed rapidly throughout the Industrial Revolution and the emerging modern era, splintering off into independent schools of thought, and the interdisciplinary view of the Earth as a superorganism quickly became overshadowed. However, in the 1970s, two scientists formulated a different outlook, one that was viewed upon as pseudoscience at the time. A chemist named James Lovelock and a microbiologist named Lynn Margulis formulated what is now known as the Gaia hypothesis, and as time went on, they seem to have gathered some pretty startling evidence. The strangest and most intriguing thing about our planet is that from a scientific perspective, it breathes. As they studied Earth's global biosphere, Margulis and Lovelock quickly realized that it has all of the properties of a life form. If we approached it from a parts-for-parts basis, planet Earth is very much a living organism. For the most part, our planet seems to display what is known as homeostasis, or the ability of self-regulation, a process that is exhibited in all living creatures in the necessity to maintain a state of equilibrium to keep something alive. In fact, many of Earth's life-sustaining qualities exhibit a remarkable stability. The temperature range of our climate, the oxygen content of our atmosphere, the pH level, chemistry, and salinity of our oceans, all of these are biologically mediated. created. After hundreds of millions of years, all of these processes have stayed within a range where life can thrive, and thus the totality of all life on Earth is interacting with its environments in an intricate and majestic way that regulate these global qualities. In this respect, Earth is very much a living organism, a creature, Gaia. When we take a look at other planets too, their properties only serve to confirm the Gaia hypothesis. When we peer through our solar system with an infrared lens, Mars and Venus have atmospheres that are dominated by carbon dioxide, which is what you'd expect from those distributions of elements. But when we take a look at Earth, it is an entirely different and beautiful kettle of fish. When we look at the interplanetary atmospheres of Mars and Venus, Earth sticks out like a sore thumb. We have methane, hydrocarbon, and oxygen reacting all the time, burning like a flame. And because of that, if you were looking at our planet from deep within the cosmos and took one look at our atmosphere, it would be as if the planet itself was shouting out, "We're alive! What's up? What's going on? My name is Earth, and I'm a superorganism." If these systems exist, which they do, then something must be regulating it. And that's because Earth itself is regulating it through all of these interwoven and intricate systems of idiosyncratic life. In fact, even more clearly defined evidence is coming to light in recent times. Tim Lenton, an Earth system scientist at the University of Exeter, explains that we can even witness Earth breathing through scientific processes. In fact, you can pick up Earth's breathing patterns from the CO2 that has been captured by detectors spread out across the planet, a rhythm that moves with the night and the day. Isn't that incredible? The Earth breathes, and we can witness it in real time through science. We could sit here all day and talk about revelation after revelation, bearing witness to our astounding planet Earth in all of its infinite wonder. But like I said in our opening few statements, this isn't anything new. The notion of our planet being a living entity has long been a part of our shared consciousness. It just seems that we may have forgotten the reality of the matter. And if that's the case, I think we may well have a little bit of making up to do. Well, there we have it, our long and short answer to the question, what if the Earth was alive? It is, and we better well treat her good, as we'll probably end up like Mars or something. And if, like me, you hate getting sand in your socks, then nobody wants that. What did you guys think? Do you have any interesting insights to add to the matter? Why don't you let us know your thoughts down in the comment section below? Before we depart from today's video, though, let's first take a quick look at some of your more resounding remarks from over the past few days. Wilson Scraddock says, "My uncle fell into Jupiter once, and he was fine afterwards." Wow, that's pretty impressive actually, Wilson. I tried it once, and then that whole red spot thing happened. Yeah, that was my finest moment. And finally, I Break Stuff says, "To save you 9 minutes, you die." But not in this video, I Break Stuff, because this video is the complete opposite to that, so what a bamboozle. Well, unfortunately, folks, that's all we've got time for in today's video. Just sticking around all the way until the end. If you were a fan of this video or just Life's Biggest Questions in general, then please be a dear and hit that thumbs up button, as well as that subscribe bell. And I'll be seeing you in the next one. As per usual, I've been your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch. You've been watching Life's Biggest Questions. And until next time, you take it easy.